Let's look at some of these genes that have such a big impact on early development. These are generally referred to as regulatory genes. And they're important to us here because just one or two mutations can have such very large phenotypic effects. What I'd like to focus on are what are called homeobox genes. This is often referred to just as HOX genes. There are four different homeobox genes that regulate the body plans of all animals. That means there's homologous genes, homeobox genes, found both in vertebrates, insects, just about everything else. So one of these affects the tail end of an insect larva, and it also affects the mouse embryo at the tail end, which ultimately grows up to be the tail end of the fruit fly and the tail of the mouse. This red one has impacts on the head, both in the fly and in the mouse. So here are these four different homeobox genes and the different parts of the body that they affect. Now, what's extraordinary about these genes is that you mess around with them, you get a mutation on one of those HOX genes, and the mutants can be bizarre. So here is the leg of a fruit fly that has a mutation in its HOX gene, and it's its front leg, so that'd be its leg up here, but it's growing an eye out of its knee. Okay? So these genes have huge, huge effects. And in vertebrates, there are four different homeobox genes that regulate the development of our forelimb. And one of them works on these bones here, a few in the fingers. A separate gene works on these other finger bones. This other gene works now in the wrist again, and so on. So each one, a mutation, would cause pretty big changes in the size or the shape of these bones all throughout the whole hand. Now, these HOX genes are important because they act as master switches. They turn on and they turn off other genes during embryonic development. These HOX genes determine the fate of each cell of the embryo, and this assures that the body parts form properly. So they have a huge role in this early development. So let's say we have a specific HOX gene that may influence this side of a growing limb bud. This HOX gene also has an influence on the side, but also at the tip. When the organism grows up, this will have an effect on whether it has fingers as opposed to, say, a flipper. So just a few genes may be involved that ultimately cause enormous differences in the forelimb. One of the things we know in our own evolutionary tree with the tetrapods, going any land animal, is that the earliest tetrapods all had seven or eight different fingers and toes, okay, on each limb. And through time, this has changed, and so now we just have five. Mutant flies can still grow four wings. The earliest members of this lineage also had four wings. Somewhere in evolution, the flies dropped two of their wings and they became diptera, which means two wings. So we have mutations that can cause a doubling in the number of wings in flies. It can affect how many fingers and toes we have, whether we even have fingers versus having flippers. There is a particular HOX gene called PAX6 that is interesting in terms of our discussion of the eye. So even though we allowed for the possibility of the eye to evolve through 1800 small steps, maybe there were a few larger changes that occurred. We know that a mutant in the PAX6 gene can cause very large changes in eye structure. This individual has no irises. That's the pupil all the way out to the edge of what would be the iris. And that's caused by a mutation in the PAX6. And again, this is a mutation that's very deep in our ancestry. And so here's a blind mouse that has a mutation. It's the same gene that affects sight in mammals as it does in the sight of insects. So these PAX6 mutants affect eyes of mammals and insects, despite fundamental differences in the architecture of our eyes. The last example I want to show you is called UBX. This is a HOX gene that suppresses leg development in fruit flies. And this particular gene regulates how many legs the developing fly will have. And it turns on just these three segments of the thorax so that they develop legs. So this is the larva, the maggot, and out of three segments in what will eventually become the thorax, legs will appear. If you turn off the effects of that UBX gene, then the fruit flies will develop legs out of every single segment. Okay, so they'll grow up with dozens of legs, not just six. There's another mutant form of UBX that actually prevents any buds from forming whatsoever. So a single mutation that causes a fly that would ordinarily grow six legs to have none whatsoever. Now the reason this is such an interesting example, I've shown other weird mutants before, but this one's particularly interesting because a mutation of the same gene that regulates how many legs a fly has, if you have that mutation in one of the crustacea, the kind of organism that eventually gave rise to the modern insects, this mutation doesn't suppress all of the legs in the developing crustacean. It represses just a percentage of them. What we see is that modern-day invertebrates, whether they're brine shrimp, fruit flies, mosquitoes, velvet worms, all carry this UBX gene. And there are different precise forms of the gene in the different species. In the six-legged ones, for fruit flies and mosquitoes, it's very similar. And so this brown shows the regions are the same in those two. But there has been alteration from the earlier form, which is typified by the brine shrimp. There's a lot of change in the UBX gene from the crustacean ancestral state to the modern insects. Now, the mutations that we see in this particular gene are known to regulate how many legs can develop, and the mutation that gave rise to the modern insects or is involved with their rise would have allowed their crustacean ancestors to lose a lot of those abdominal legs, which we see in this, to become six-legged insects. Now, if we look at the development of these larvae in modern organisms, in the normal Drosophila, as we've already seen, there's just these three buds that are growing, and so it will have six legs. That's because it has a particular form of the UBX gene. There's a mutation in the UBX gene, though, that will cause all the legs to be suppressed. So this poor maggot will grow up to have no legs as an adult. But if we have this same mutation that leads to legless flies, if we have that same mutation in the crustacean, then instead of having a crustacean that produces a dozen pair of legs, it only produces three pairs. It too will produce six-legged offspring. So that's a single mutation that has this huge effect. It's one of the homeobox genes, and it's called UBX. So, to summarize Darwin and macroevolution, Darwin's original concept of gradual change is still our kind of default explanation for how traits are likely to have altered through time. And indeed, there are a lot of quantitative traits, that is, multi-locus traits, where you have lots of different loci influencing the same phenotypic trait. These traits are common, and mutations on all those different loci generally do just have a small effect on physical characteristics. Unlike the rather bizarre claims of the creationists, there have indeed been a lot of intermediate forms found in the fossil record. And we do have, even amongst living organisms, intermediate forms for major evolutionary novelties like eyes, as we saw in the mollusks, and insect wings, where we saw the gill flaps in the stoneflies. However, we do very much have a more modern appreciation that there are genes, these regulatory genes, like the homeobox or the Hox genes, that can have very, very large phenotypic effects. And the consequence of this is this reduces the number of intermediate steps to go from a simple form to a more complex one, which may have been involved with the evolution of the feathers from simple spines to more complex structures. And these homeobox genes also likely constrain the final form of a trait. Why it is we have five fingers as opposed to six? Why insects have six legs instead of 10?